Well, hey there again, everybody. As we talked about before, we're sort of continuing this At the Movie series where we're talking about popular film. The ones so far have all been new film. Next week, we're going to check out a classic together that I'm excited about. And this week is sort of a football week. The timing worked out for the Chiefs to be playing, and of course the Chiefs to have won yesterday as we're checking out American Underdog today, which is a story about Kurt Warner. And the truth is, I saw some of our friends wearing St. Louis Rams stuff as their favorite football team. The St. Louis Rams would also be my favorite football team, the St. Louis Rams. I don't care too much for the Los Angeles Rams, but I do love the St. Louis Rams. And so this Kurt Warner story in what happened with that football team is a part of my life, a part of my childhood, and so it's exciting to see that. We're going to be connecting that message into a true scriptural gospel message today about what it means to pursue our dreams and chase our dreams and why it matters that Christians are dream-chasing people. And so for that, why don't we check out the trailer to find out a little bit more about American Underdog.
You wanted to see me, sir.
Sit down, Kurt.
Thank you, Coach. I prefer to stand.
All right. Go ahead, then. Tell me.
Tell you what.
Why, a team worth $800 million, one of the most complex offenses ever built, should put you in the driver's seat. You're too old to be a rookie, too green to be a pro. So why in the world would I give you this shot?
All my life, I've defined myself through sports. I've always come up empty.
Coach, I can win for you.
You need to start thinking about life after football, son.
We gave you the chance. We're letting you go.
I was meant for something. Something more.
You think you could be that guy?
Yeah, I do.
What are you doing here?
I wasn't ready for it, but I am now.
You defied all odds.
I've waited for it. I've bled for it. I know who I am, and I know why I'm here. If you give me a chance.
Green went down hard and is not getting up.
I will not let you down.
Special about you, son. Destiny. Come on, so the underdogs. You want to prove that?
So this movie came out at the end of 2021, came out in Christmas of 21, which is why it said this Christmas there, 2021. Who saw this film? Did anybody see it? I saw it. I would totally recommend it. I'm a person who's skeptical about these types of movies. I really am. If you know that about me, it's like, you know, it involves faith, and usually I just can't do it, guys. And so I was skeptical, and I was late to the party. But it's great. It's on Hulu. If you have Hulu right now, you can check it out and watch it when you get home. And so that's where you can check out this movie on your own if you have a Hulu subscription. But if you're not familiar with the story of Kurt Warner, it is a story about a guy who goes from stocking shelves at Hy-Vee to 2 years later, winning a Super Bowl, becoming the NFL MVP, Super Bowl MVP as quarterback of the St. Louis Rams. It is a story stranger than fiction. If you pitch it to Hollywood, it's too unbelievable. But this is the life that Kurt Warner lived. It's about, but the movie entails much more than just football. It talks about his life and his relationship with his wife, Brenda. There's Kurt and his wife, Brenda, who've done so many stupendous things, and his adoption of Brenda's children as well, and that relationship the movie involves as well. The fascinating life of Kurt Warner, who's now an NFL Hall of Famer, spends his time on NFL Network and is in the media constantly. It's a tremendous story. And it all started at Northern Iowa University for Kurt Warner. It's a small school, not known for its football prowess. And so that's a problem for a guy who has a dream of not only making it to the NFL, but playing in the NFL. You should probably be playing for your college team if you want to play in the NFL. And Kurt finds himself struggling to find playing time and doesn't quite understand why. And so he approaches his coach about why he can't get on the field. and he hears a little bit of harsh reality. Check it out.
You don't stay in the pocket.
What?
You got the talent, loads of it, but when things get hard, you bail. You run from adversity. You don't trust your team or my playbook. You don't deserve to play in the game.
Coach, 10 more games and my dream is gone. I've been working my whole life for this, please.
You need to start thinking about life after football, son.
Respectfully, you are wrong, Coach. I'm not gonna quit, because that's not what leaders do. I just need to know how to get on that field. Blue 80, hat!
Cannot leave the pocket. You want your shot? You take the pain.
So to this point in his life and in his football career, Kurt Warner has gotten where he's gotten simply because he's that good. And now he realizes it's a little bit more difficult than that. See, even his coach affirms the dream is there, the talent is there, the ability is there. But did you hear the criticism of the coach? When things get hard, you bail. When things get hard, you bail. And he found out in this moment that if he wanted to get where he wanted to go, it was going to have to get a lot tougher from there. He was going to have to take a beating physically, mentally, emotionally. Kurt was going to have to be willing to do some things he's never done before in order to get to a place where he wants to be. And so he does just that. He ends up playing at the University of Northern Iowa and hopes to get drafted. He doesn't get drafted, but ends up finding a job on the practice squad and in training camp for the Green Bay Packers. Spends a week with Green Bay before losing that job, and then that's when he finds himself looking for a job and stocking shelves at the Hy-Vee. But what ends up happening with Kurt is he actually signs with the upstart Arena Football League. The Arena Football League is no longer in operation, but from the 90s to I think the mid-2000s was a somewhat popular endeavor, totally different game. But the upstart Arena Football League, he plays for the Iowa Barnstormers, which was a little bit different than he expected. Let's see.
Warner under center, surveys the defense. And for the first time this season, there is actual excitement in this arena.
Hey, come on, let's go.
Yeah, here.
What is this?
It's a touchdown bonus.
You pay me per touchdown?
I also pay you to win. Did you even read your contract? Teach him to read, man.
Wait, really, $100? Every single touchdown?
Every touchdown.
Happy to pay it.
That's going to be fun.
Not exactly the NFL. If you know anything about the Arena League, these guys were practicing in barns. Literally, there no lines on, no nothing, just wherever they could possibly find space. Because the arenas that they were playing in were multi-purpose arenas. It's not like they could just use the arena to practice all week long. They're practicing on concrete, on open fields, and barns, wherever they could possibly find space. Not exactly the NFL. See, Kurt was willing to go to a place nobody wanted to go to. Playing in the Arena League was not one step closer to the NFL. It was a step further away from the NFL, but you still got to keep playing football. He was willing to go to a place nobody else wanted to go to chase his dream. See, somewhere along this road, Kurt realized that if you want to go places nobody gets to go, you have to do things nobody wants to do. If you want to go places nobody gets to go, you have to do things nobody else wants to do. And so he does that in the Arena League. He does that by stocking shelves. He keeps his dream alive. Kurt Warner, at this point in his football career, it was nice to have money in his pocket, but as far as football was concerned, he didn't just have to hit rock bottom. He was living in rock bottom in order to pursue his dreams. See, He didn't think arena, maybe he thought Arena League was going to be the end for him, but in his mind, he still wanted to chase the dream of playing in the National Football League. Kurt decided he would do anything to see that dream become a reality. He knew that if he wanted to get where few people get to go, he had to be willing to do what few people are willing to do to get there. Do you have a dream? Did you have a dream at one point? I don't just mean something you do. I mean something that you feel like you were born to do, something you have to do. The thing that deep down in your bones, this is what you are supposed to do with your life. Maybe that's connected to your occupation, maybe it's not. Maybe it's connected to your former occupation, maybe it's not. But we all have a dream, this thing we're supposed to be doing with our lives. The thing we were created for. And sometimes the dreams change, don't they? Probably not a great dream for someone who's 75 to want to play quarterback in the NFL. So our dreams change. But what dream is it that God has called you to chase? It's never too late to chase our dreams. Our dreams might have to change, but it is never too late. God is constantly calling us. And one of the problems, friends, is that our sinful world beats us up, tells us it's not worth it, tells us we can't do it, tells us it's not right for us. And we give up because chasing it proves to be too difficult. We grow unwilling to do what it takes to do the thing God has placed on our heart. And we find a similar story in our Old Testament in Genesis. God gives a man a dream, and God asks him to chase it. This man's name is Abram. You may know him as Abraham. And here's Abram's story, found in Genesis 12. Here's what it says. The Lord said to Abram, "Go from your country, your people, and your father's house to the land that I will show you." Anybody need better directions than that before you leave? I do. "Leave everything behind and go to the land that I will show you. I will make you a great nation and I will bless you. I will make your name great and you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and whoever curses you, I will curse. And all the peoples on earth will be blessed through you." So a couple unique things here. First is, in the Hebrew mindset, those who were blessed were those who were a part of the Jewish Hebrew family. But what does God tell Abram here? God will bless who through Abram? All the peoples on earth will be blessed through Abram. God says, if you follow this calling, I will make everything come together for you. It will happen just as I need it to. You just have to stick to the plan. Here's Abram's response. So Abram went as the Lord had told him, and Lot went with him. Pay attention to this next line. Abram was 75 years old when he set out from Haran. Abram was 75 years old when he set out from Haran. How many answers to all of Abram's questions did God provide Abram? Zero. Zero answers. The only question was, what am I supposed to do? Answer, go. That's all. But Abram left. All Abram knew was that God was asking him to do something big, something that all of the nations of the world would be blessed if he followed through. The dream here is to bless all the nations of the world, to make God known to all the nations of the world. But it meant doing what no one else was willing to do. It meant complete surrender and obedience to God, not just in the law, but in these special instructions that God had given just Abram. It meant leaving his country behind. It meant his allegiance comes first to his God. It meant leaving his people for the same reason. Living a life of complete uncertainty. The only thing that Abram was certain of was that he was going to be blessed if he did it because God told him so. The question was just if Abram would live like he actually believes that. See, if you ask me, yeah, I believe that. The way I live my life does not reflect that I actually truly believe that. So would Abram actually do what God has called him to do? Abram had no idea what was going to happen along the way. We could tell a lot of stories about this guy, Abraham, in worship. No idea what was going to happen to him along the way. No idea what was going to happen to his family. No idea where he was going. No idea what God wanted. All God wanted at this point was Abram, and Abram was willing to surrender it for what God had called him to. And God gave him that call at what age? 75. Now we can talk about biblical aging and dating, a different conversation. 75. We don't know if for the first 74 years of Abram's life, Abram was like, I don't know what really my purpose is here on earth. And then he finally got it at 75, or maybe he lived a great life of purpose for those previous 74 years, and that's exactly why God called him to do something new. This is all we know. All we know is that what God had in store for him was not probably on Abram's preferred timeline. It didn't all unravel just the way Abram would have imagined. But see, here's the difference between the types of dreams people chase and the type of dreams Christians chase. Abram is set out to chase whose dream? God's dream. Not our own, which means different timeline. It doesn't always go exactly the way that we want, but it's a calling. So Abram did what no one else was willing to do to pursue it. And Abraham's primary focus was not to make himself great. His primary focus was to simply be obedient to the call that God had put before him. In the movie, when it looks like Kurt's dream of playing in the NFL is never going to become reality, Kurt is talking to his girlfriend in the movie, Brenda, now his wife, and he says, why would God give me a dream that's never going to come true? Have you thought that before? Why would God give me a dream that will never come true? Have you ever felt like the dream that you have will almost certainly not come true? See, but what we can learn from the film and from Abraham together is that if God calls us to chase a dream, God is going to do something to make it happen. It might not shake out exactly the way that you think. The first step for Abram was probably different than all the rest. But God is going to make it happen if we're courageous and obedient enough to chase the thing that God has put on our heart. Because I bet if you ask Kurt even today, despite the tremendous story, he probably would have told you when he was 26 years old and playing the Arena League, he would have preferred to start playing in the NFL at 22 or 23. He wouldn't want to go down the path that he went down. He wasn't sure if the Arena League was it for him or not. But he kept working, and others began to take notice. He kept chipping away at his dream, and others began to notice. Let's see.
Oh, my pleasure, yeah. Thanks for coming out. Sorry we didn't win.
Kurt. Hey, Kurt. Excuse us, Brenda. The gentleman here to see you.
Yeah, my pleasure. No, stay here. That's fine.
Heck of a game for you, Kurt.
Well, thank you, but it didn't help us win. I hate to lose, sir. I hate it for the team.
I'm David Gillis. We've been trying to reach you. We want you to come try out for us.
Try out?
I've been putting off his calls for a while. Can you blame me?
I'm sorry. Who are you?
I'm with the Rams.
He got another chance. See, but this is an invite. This isn't a contract. This isn't a spot on the team. This isn't a certain place on the depth chart. It's an invitation to come try out. And this is a risk for Kurt. He leaves the Arena League, where he's a sure thing, making $100 a touchdown. Maybe next year he'll make $150 a touchdown. And he walks away from that for a chance at this dream. The courage it took to walk away from what was a sure and comfortable thing for him, where he was a star in the Arena League, to be a hopeful for the St. Louis Rams, who, if you know anything about the Rams in the 90s, until the very end, not good. That's why they were looking for guys in the Arena League. But it was a chance. And ultimately, the Rams do give him a shot to be on their roster. Here's a conversation he has with the Rams coach, Dick Vermeil, who's played by the great Dennis Quaid. Let's see.
I burn out. Not embarrassed to say it. Took a year off. Turned out to be a decade and a half. When I did come back, they said I was retread. Has been too old. Game had passed me by. All that stuff. All that same stuff that they're going to say about you. What they didn't know was all that experience that I had in those years made me who I am. Made me ready for this moment. Gave me something others didn't have. And I see that in you, Kurt. Destiny. It belongs to the underdogs.
So he finally gets his chance. He's on the roster for the St. Louis Rams. He's on the roster. A dream fulfilled. Sort of. He's not first on the depth chart. He's not expected to play at all. It took a series of circumstances, including a preseason injury to the Rams starting quarterback, Trent Green. That's me and my dad with Trent Green when I was a kid, when he played for the St. Louis Rams. Actually, Trent and his family went to our church in St. Louis when he was playing in St. Louis, and my dad, who was the pastor there, baptized Trent's youngest son, Derek, while we were there. And if you remember Chiefs fans, Trent Green went on, spent a few years in Kansas City, was a Pro Bowl quarterback there for a couple of years, so we saw success after that injury with the Rams. But once Trent Green went down, Kurt Warner stepped up, and Trent never got his job back because Kurt began to play so well, it was undeniable. He went on to win MVP that year, but it's not so easy. Remember, we're talking about a guy that went from Northern Iowa to no job to an Arena League, and now he's playing in the NFL. Spent some time in Europe, the project called NFL Europe, and now he's the starting quarterback of the St. Louis Rams, as you heard earlier, for one of the most complex offenses ever. One of the most successful offenses ever, with or without Kurt. Through all the doubts and questions about whether he really has what it takes to make it happen, it begins to all come together for him. Let's see.
And Kurt Warner, he's confident because he certainly has something to prove.
Kurt led the Rams to a 13-3 record. Went on to win NFL MVP. Remember, this is just out of the Arena League here, friends. NFL MVP leads the Rams to a Super Bowl win and wins Super Bowl MVP while he's at it. From the bottom to the top. Not just in a career, not just in a life, but in a matter of a couple of years. probably not the couple of years that Kurt would have picked for himself, but in a matter of a couple of years, in pursuit of this dream, this thing that he thought defined him, he says, I've defined my entire life by football. Along the way, he meets his wife, Brenda, his future wife, Brenda, and her children, and he decides to adopt them. See, he sees along the way as he pursues his dream that the real way that he defines himself and the real dream that he wants to pursue with his life and what truly matters in his life is completely changing for him. He lived for a totally different purpose now. Let's see him talk about it in the film.
All my life, I've defined myself through sports. What I could accomplish, how many games I could win. And I've always come up empty. It's never been enough. Like I was meant for something else, something more.
What if it's this? What if it's us together? Everything I could ever want or need is right here. It doesn't matter if I play football or if I don't play football or if I do play football, where I play football, none of that matters. Because winning isn't winning if I don't have you by my side. I've made my choice.
So the dream that he thought he was chasing becomes meaningless for something even better. See, now instead of football being the means and the end, football has now become a means to an end for Kurt Warner. To be able to share love in a new way, to be able to experience life in a new way. He realized that before, as he pursued a dream, he pursued a dream for who? For Kurt. It was all about what I wanted and about the wins and about the stats and about the success. And now he realizes that's not what it's about at all. If that's all I had, I don't have much. But if I can pursue this dream of playing quarterback in the NFL while pursuing the dream of being able to share and to have love like never before, that's what gives everything meaning. The dream he kept chasing, even after he made it big, didn't fulfill him in the way he thought it would. What did fulfill him was love. So what if the dream that you are chasing, the idea in your head, the calling that's been placed on your heart, isn't all there is to it? What if there's more along the way that you realize that's what it's really about? Because if the dream that we're chasing, we're saying we're chasing it for God, but it doesn't include seek ye first his kingdom, then that dream is for us. If our dream doesn't include that, it isn't the dream that God has in store for us. If it isn't about sharing love and grace with others in a new way that God has uniquely gifted us to do, that's not it for us. Our dream should be, how can I use my unique passions and abilities to share God's love with others? That's where fulfillment comes from. But we can't give up on it when life gets hard. Abram left his country, his people, everything behind for a dream that God had given him that he couldn't even define in pursuit of God's call. Jesus left heaven and came to earth, left the comforts of heaven and came to earth to what? Live in homelessness, experience hatred, experience not just death, but the worst death imaginable to pursue the calling of God. And yet you and I say, it takes too much time. I don't have the money. I don't have the skill. I don't have the help. Fill in the blank for yourself when it gets hard. We let lack of confidence get in our way. We let uncertainty stand in our way. We let our own agenda stand in our way to pursue the calling that God has given us. God has put this calling on our life for a reason, and our Savior went to the grave for that calling. And if we want to experience the life of Christ within us, we have to be willing to do the same for the calling God has put on our hearts. So what would it look like if the church was filled with people who pursue wild dreams? Is that how you think the world around us perceives the church? I don't. I think people perceive the church as a place where we can come and we can be safe and made comfortable and feel loved. That's not wrong. That just shouldn't be what it's all about. Maybe if the church was filled with people who pursue wild dreams that God has given us, people might call us crazy. Because it's different than what the world says to do. But wouldn't that show the trust we have in God? Wouldn't that show the love that we feel from God? That I feel such love from my God that it doesn't really matter if these other things don't work out or if I fail. I think if we live that kind of life as a church, it would make people who don't know God's love come to know God's love. It would make God the only thing we relied on in life. Here's a statement that I think we can go home with. If the church was filled with people who relentlessly pursued their calling, the world would be filled with people who relentlessly pursue Jesus. If the church was filled with people who relentlessly pursue their calling, the world would be filled with people who relentlessly pursue Jesus. Isn't that what it's all about? Isn't that what our dreams are for, ultimately? The giver of those dreams doesn't just want you to have those for you, but he not just wants to have them for God, but wants you to have those dreams and pursue them for others, that they might have the same type of love and hope that we do. Let that be our dream, that the church will be filled with people who relentlessly pursue dreams, that the world will be filled with people who relentlessly pursue Jesus.